copy of the Open Meetings Act is located on the entrance wall to room 903. We have 5 agenda items, and the first is a renewal RFP to flex spending account agreement.
I can start.
Okay.
HR, probably can help out. So currently, PayFlex handles our flex account administration, and we have a contract with them that expires into the year. And currently, and in the past, for I think about the past 9 years, Aflac actually has paid the fees for that. And about a week ago, Aflac informed us that they don't want to pay the fees anymore, and that they would pay through the end of this year, but not beyond that. It's at least for last year, it was approximately $26,000 a year that that Aflac has paid. And so the question is, what do we want to do for the pay plan beginning January of 2017 in terms of, does the county board want to go out for an RFP? Does the county board first want to have AM talk to PayFlex and see what our renewal rates might be? We have not heard from them yet because we are several months out. We have plenty of time. So I talked to Tracy Crossy. She said that AM could definitely contact PayFlex and see what the renewal rates would be, and then they could also do an RFP if that's what the board wants to do. But we do need to, the county board just has to designate them as our broker, AON as our broker for this particular contract, because they didn't handle it in the first place. And so that's just kind of a formality.
So that's if we do or don't go out for an RFP, right?
Probably either way,
yeah.
So that they can represent us. And they said they would do that at no additional cost.
Okay.
I don't think there's been any complaints about PayFlex.
No.
But it's been for 9 years, you said?
Well, we went out for an RFP back in 2011. That's when we picked Aflac. They said they would do it for free, although they were, I mean, they would cover the costs, although they had been doing that for a while. Then we had to switch to WageWorks because Aflac got out of the business of doing it. And then WageWorks provided us not the best service. So then we went to PayFlex, which was one of the bidders originally, but we didn't RFP it again. We just spoke to them, got there, and went with what they bid in the first place. So we technically have not bid it since, or we have not done an RFP since 2011.
I did an RFP, including PayFlex, probably less than 18 months ago, right around there probably, and they were second best on price, but by far the best service-wise. They're one of the only large processors that's located in Omaha as our headquarters, which makes it very nice. I know that Sarpy County just recently switched away from PlayFlex to ASI, and I've been speaking with them, and they are already experiencing major problems with ASI.
So we've really only had the PayFlex. It was Aflac we've had for 9 years.
But PayFlex has been handling the administration for the last 3 years. So.
3 years.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So their so it was a 3-year contract, and it's up at the end of the year. But there's an automatic renewal. It's just the fees are subject to change. And they have to give us at least 120 days notice. But we thought we could start talking about it earlier, especially since Aflac has said.
And there isn't, or is there, a deal for going out for bid with the Aflac stuff, or is that just a
automatic
thing, kind of, they came on and we said yes, and
they're kind of they're a voluntary optional.
Yeah.
I know at Sarpy County, they would let multiple vendors come in for the same exact product, and that was not bad. It would create a little bit of burden because HR coordinated it, but when it's voluntary, usually the benefit of not having an RFP for the voluntary services is there's kind of a hand length on liability then for issues. So
Aflac was paying the fees for administration because that we would let them be exclusive. So this will be an expenditure that we're not used to paying for 9 years.
But then it also opens up
yeah.
yes.
but they're not exclusive anymore. Do they know that?
Yeah, I mean, we talked to them, they understood that. They, I don't think that we ever said you were exclusive. Maybe it was just known that, I mean, if, I don't know if other companies came and approached anyone and said, hey, we'd like to do this too. Because there is a process that the county board has for, you know, automatic payroll reduction. And so anybody, I suppose, could have gone through that process and also been, you know, a vendor. I'm not aware of anybody trying it, or if they just didn't because they knew Aflac had such a presence.
It doesn't seem like anybody has,
not
we're aware of.
No, not that I'm aware of.
I think there's been a couple of, like that Northwestern
Mutual
or whatever, yeah. They're kind of interested now, offering something voluntarily, and there's another one too.
There's a lot of companies that are out in the market, you know, that I think would be interested in being able to get a foot in the door here,
yeah,
if they thought that was a possibility. But I don't know if Aflac has communicated that they had an exclusive deal.
Yeah, we don't.
It's
know.
A very close community. People move from one
right.
company to the
right.
other and
right.
back, and
right.
so.
So Aon hasn't done anything, or they are reaching out to see what the pricing would be.
They requested that. I told them I'd be talking to you, and they really need what they need is a letter from the county board that says we will let you be our broker of record, and then they can reach out to them. So they can provide me with that long letter. But no, they haven't done anything.
And so for, and again, it was a 3-year contract. So I suppose it wouldn't hurt to go back out just to see.
Do you want me to communicate to them to first, and I don't know which is better, to first talk to Payflex and see what the renewal rates would be? And then, based on what Aon thinks of those, determine whether or not to RFP it? Or just
I'm
straight to RFP?
That's right. I don't know legally if that's what they would do.
Well, it's a professional services agreement,
mm-hmm.
and we do have within the contract, you can renew it for 12 months at a time.
So
yeah.
If we don't like it, then we can go out for RFP.
Exactly.
Okay, if that's legal, yeah.
I think you can renew the contract that you already have. I have to look at what they're doing and see whether it was professional or not. A lot of people keep things, but you can renew the contract that you already have.
Well, it's inside professional service, because if it wasn't, we would have had to go out for bid, which we didn't. We went for RFP. So it has to be professional service.
Yeah, I'm just saying I have looked at it closely to see what
tasks
are that they're performing.
Regardless, we have a $26,000 expenditure
that we didn't have before.
Yeah, and if we would pay it, we would just pay it out of the health insurance fund.
There's
the money in there.
Okay.
Okay,
so I'll contact Tracy.
Yeah, the wellness, Vivari's contract is up at the end of 2016. So I guess it was just something we were going to talk about to see if you wanted to go out for an RFP on that as well. I definitely have my opinions on it and would wish that we didn't, and we would renew with them. At this time, I don't think we know. I think we've reached out to Aon to see if they would reach out to Vivari to let us know if there's any increase in their fees. But we started in July of 2014. So we had a half a year in 2014. We had a full year in 15. And so now we're just a quarter of the way through 16. And truthfully, we're just now starting to get our numbers up. We went from 226 people who completed their points to get their reward in 14 to 396 in 15. And as of today, I have 466 who've met that first tier, meaning they get the first $100. and 283 that have already met their 200 points, which they don't have to have till December 1st. So I think the program is finally this year growing enough to get the interest, because we did that two-tier thing. And, you know, 650 people have logged in compared to when we first started, 391. So to change a vendor at this juncture, I think, would be not a good move, just because I think people are starting to get used to it, and, you know, having them for 5 or 6 years, so you have some measurability on, you know, enough population doing it. That's just my take on it and recommendation. And the portal's a great portal. The employees, you know, are really adapting to it, and it's very easy to do the things they need to do. So, I mean, I got employees right now that are 400 points. So,
when's that first check come out? Because I don't have
one. I know you haven't, because you know what?
First gift card.
Yeah, I'm waiting, because I had ordered 400 $100 gift cards, which is $40,000, right? $40,000, yeah. And so I thought that was going to be enough, thinking that last year in total we gave 396 total cards. So I thought, you know, I could order 400 and be safe. But I've got 200 that are waiting right now for the cards. I've just ordered them again. Okay. So
I got mine in the mail.
You should have got yours.
Administrator get his in the county.
You should have got yours. It was in that same packet.
Did you see the dollar sign fiscal director county director?
No, you should have yours. It's in the same packet. I bet it's sitting on your desk.
I understand.
But I've got a group.
That would come in the mail, wouldn't it?
No, it's through inner office, yeah. But I've got a group that I'm waiting for as soon as I get the cards. So I guess I see the program really moving, and would like to continue without having any disruption.
Okay.
Hopefully providing that there is no increase, you know, or it's minor.
And that again is what Aon would...
Yeah, they're already the program director on that one.
All right.
Yep.
Everybody in consensus anyway? We're not voting. Consensus that that's what we do? All right. Item 3, discussion regarding paid sick leave for federal contractors.
Yes. Okay. I have a little presentation I thought might be easy to go through. One of the things that is kind of a new experience for me is that I have not worked for an organization until coming to Douglas County, where we've had to worry a lot about federal contracts. And so federal contracts bring a whole nother set of laws through the OFCCP, the Office of Federal Contract Compliance. And so there's a number of executive orders that have come out recently that are gonna impact us, because we have two very large departments that are affected by federal contracts: the Health Center and Department of Corrections. So the memo kind of highlights what's on the PowerPoint presentation, but the executive order was actually passed in September of last year. And basically the purpose of the executive order is that it's to seek to obtain economy and efficiency in government procurement. With federal contractors. And so they believe that allowing employees to earn 7 days or more of paid sick leave annually, including paid leave allowing for family care, will allow those federal contractors to remain competitive employers, and therefore that will increase the efficiency of the organizations that the federal government contracts with. The U.S. Secretary of Labor published this quote associated with this particular executive order, which is that mom and dad should be able to stay at home with a sick child, and that they believe that if companies are doing business with the federal government, that they need to provide their employees with paid sick leave. We already provide employees with paid sick leave, both part-time and full-time employees.
Or 20 hours.
For anybody that's part-time.
Under 20 hours?
Yes.
They just don't get health insurance, but they do get sick leave.
Yes, they get sick and vacation.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's prorated on the hours they work, but that's kind of where the rub comes in here a little bit. We're covered by the McNamara-Harris Service Contract Act, which basically requires that says we're a federal contractor, and depending upon the dollar amount of the contract determines whether we fall under the Service Contract Act for information related to wages and benefits, or whether we're just, if it's under 2,500, it's the Fair Labor Standards Act. Our contracts are well in excess of $2,500. The Service Contract Act covers contracts with state and political subdivisions, so that applies to us. And so it doesn't contain any, the SCA doesn't contain any exemption for state or municipal or local employees, governmental agencies. And so we have to comply with that. So this is what the new executive order is saying. It says that we have to give employees 1 hour of paid sick leave for every 30 hours they work. And it also says that we cannot set the maximum accrual of that 1 hour for every 30 hours worked at less than 56 hours a year. It also says that we have to allow employees to use sick leave for a child, parent, and a spouse, which is what our current policy is in almost all contracts and in the civil service policy manual. But it also adds domestic partner or any other individual related by blood or affinity whose close association with the employee is the equivalent of a family relationship. So it expands the use of sick leave significantly.
Now, is this for all employees in the county or just those that are contracted?
It is just for those that are under the contract.
So we could have like five people in the county, up county employees who are working at, let's say, the health department. Would that be like a grant?
Grants are excluded. So right now it's the Department of Corrections and the health center for certain.
So you could have five employees over there that get more sick leave than everybody else. Even if it's against the contract.
My understanding in talking to the health center, and that's who I talked to, and Shaq actually, Shaquille from the county attorney's office, said they view, because there's no way for them to distinguish which nurses work on which things to know whether or not they're working on actual federal contract or not working on federal contract at this moment, at this day, of this week, of this month, of this year. So they apply everything uniformly. So this, from the perspective that we're viewing it, if we continue that approach, would apply to every single employee at the health center. Now, I don't know how corrections handles that, and there's still some things that we have to research with this.
And we have a union contract.
The union contract, and we'll get to that. Right, I understand, but it says that unless the union contract's benefits are greater than this, this applies over the union contract.
This is the minimum.
Yeah.
Okay.
But is this for, like, over at corrections, just those, like, the ICE and the, or is it in the...
We're a federal contractor there because of the ICE contract.
I'm learning that.
Right.
Have they started
applying? So it just doesn't apply for those areas, it would apply for the whole facility?
Well, that's what we have to decide as an organization. How is this going to work? Because we could have employees that are working under the same union contract that have completely different sick leave benefits. And it's not going to be so much the hours that'll be the issue, it'll be when they get to use their sick leave that will be the issue.
But that's not applied yet. They're not doing that at the health center.
It does not apply yet.
Until January 1st.
Correct.
Go ahead. I have a million questions.
I know.
First I'm hearing of this.
I understand. Additionally, what it provides for besides that part of the well care or the health care, it also provides for them to use their sick leave for domestic violence, sexual assault, or stalking, including presentation or participation in a related civil or criminal legal proceeding, or to assist an individual related to that employee. So if they have a family member that is going through this and they need to support that person, then they can take sick leave for that as well. The another thing that's different than our current policy is that if an employee leaves, if they come back to work with us in 12 months, we have to restore the sick leave that they had accrued and not used on the, at the time of their separation. Additionally, the use of sick leave cannot be made contingent upon the request of the employee finding a replacement to cover any work time to be missed. So if, for example, they're going to be gone and they know that they're going to have a, some kind of a procedure and the department says, well, you can't be gone now because we can't find anybody to cover you, then we couldn't deny it. So this is a far sweeping executive order. It says that the paid sick leave required by this order is in addition to the contractor's obligation under the Service Contract Act, and contractors may not receive credit towards their prevailing wage fringe benefit obligations. And that's something that we have to do some research on because we haven't looked at that in general. But it does say that if the existing paid leave policy that's there is in addition to the fulfillment of these obligations, then we don't have to provide any additional sick leave over what we're providing now. The other thing that will be a big change for the department is that it says that the paid sick leave shall be provided upon oral request of the employee and is made at least 5 calendar days in advance. I think most of our contracts, and I know the civil service policy says 5 days, so we're at least a little better in that aspect.
Well, we don't require people to give us 5 days notice to take sick leave because a lot of times you
unless
don't know that you're
going to
be
sick. Unless it's foreseeable. If it's foreseeable. If they know that they're going to be gone 2 months from now because they're having a surgery,
right.
We do require that.
Good.
A contractor, they only require a certification from the doctor when the employee has been absent for 3 or more consecutive work days, and they don't have to provide that note until up to 30 days after the first day of the leave. Additionally, right now, department heads and elected officials, and this would mostly affect department heads, are allowed under contract and under civil service that if they think that a person has a pattern or excessive absence, they can ask for a note each time the person's gone. This would not allow that. They would have to be gone 3 days before we request, and it has to be consecutive work days. If 3 or more consecutive days of paid sick leave is used for the purposes listed, which are all the, for their family, for domestic violence, whatever, then with minimum necessary information establishing the need, this would be for the victim, if they were a victim or of stalking or domestic abuse. We can request a certification, but we can only request the minimum necessary information, and we cannot, by law, disclose it. It has to be maintained confidentially. So we have a little trouble in the county right now with us keeping ADA and FMLA information confidential in within departments. So this will be a little bit difficult for us. We would really have to train and stress hard that this information could not be released unless an employee consents. Because what we, well, and the penalty, and we'll get to that, what the penalties are, but the covered contractor cannot interfere or discriminate against an employee for taking or attempting to take this paid sick leave or for assisting other employees in claiming this right. And it says, nothing in this order shall excuse noncompliance or supersede any federal or state law or collective bargaining agreement requiring greater paid sick leave or leave benefits. So if the contract provides better benefits than this, we can go with contract. But if it's less, which ours is, we have to follow this. Regulations will be issued by September 30th of this year, and within 60 days of issuing the regulations, then contracts, then the federal agencies will be directed to implement this language in all of their contracts on or after January 1, 2017. The only good thing about this is that some of our contracts, such as I think the Veterans Administration contract at the Health Center was just entered into and doesn't expire until 2020. So unless they amend that contract, we wouldn't have to comply at the Health Center until that time.
Well, even if the contract, so say that again. So say it again, because are you saying that if we have a contract
that's in place now and doesn't contain the language,
so we don't have to implement any of the stuff until we enter in the new contract?
It applies to new contracts, but there's a list of ways you can make an old contract be deemed
a new contract.
Mutual bilateral negotiation for an amendment.
Okay.
And there's a list of things.
Yeah.
So it's you renew the contract, you extend it, unless the extension is pursuant to a term in the contract prior to December of 2016 and it's short term, the contract is amended by modification through bilateral negotiation. So there's a little list of things. You could take an old contract and you can have it deemed a new contract if you do any of those things. Otherwise, if you don't change it and it just runs, it won't be considered a new contract till you redo it.
Yeah.
Or it expires.
Yeah.
Correct.
And you have to redo it.
Then you have to redo it.
So for the Health Center, that's 2020?
That's what they told me.
Well, can we verify that?
I am going to be verifying a bunch of information. This is just an overview.
When did the order come out?
The reg came out in September of 2015.
Why are we just not learning about it now?
Because I'm just learning that we had federal contracts a while back, and so now I'm digging into executive orders that apply.
Well, good. It's good that you found that better now than later.
And the thing is at first when I read this, like even a month ago, I didn't think it was this extensive because it was the first thing that was coming out that I saw was 56 days. Mm. And we already provide benefits to employees for sick leave. But there's some other issues we have to look at because there's nothing in here that I can see that says that if they're seasonal or temporary, we also don't have to provide the sick leave. And so we're gonna have to go back and look at some of the definitions so it may expand beyond the group that
Wait,
we're already
it doesn't
providing.
Say, does it say part-time?
It says employees, and it's the definition under the Fair Labor Standards Act, it looks like, which doesn't define it by hours.
Okay, that's
And there also, there will be some regulations coming out.
Issued.
The regulations are supposed
yeah.
to come out at the end of
September
this year.
So we'll know more,
and hopefully with the fact that it only applies to new contracts starting January 1st, 2017, the feds intend this to be like a phase-in. As you renew or modify your contracts, then you'll have to start complying. So we do have a little bit of time, and we will be able to look at the final regs when they come out in September.
So is this all on all federal employees are going to get the benefit of this?
It would be people working on or in connection with a federal contract.
But I'm just asking, presumably if they do that, they would apply it to all federal employees too, right? I mean, why would they apply it to local employees who are working under a federal contract and not their own federal employees?
I couldn't answer that.
This is the precedent that's issuing. They do this a lot.
There's been a couple of executive orders that we're looking at.
There's about four, I think.
Yeah.
I'd love to know how this originated.
Diane.
That's okay.
Sorry, Mary. My arm's broken, and that's not to be.
And I wasn't going to hit it. I wanted to, but I'm not going to.
See, here's the deal. I have tennis elbow.
I do
and
too.
I can't raise my arm.
You can
stuck.
Stretch. You can stretch.
All right. I'll try.
So at this point, where we're pretty certain that we're going to have to create some additional sick leave policies. The other thing that this is, in my opinion, probably going to impact is that it's going to impact the clerk's office. Because we may have to look at setting up multiple accrual plans for
sick
leave.
Our plan is not to set up any accrual plans. We can do it. There's not that many people we're talking about.
Well,
at corrections.
It could potentially be all of corrections.
Yeah, but they all earn how
more?
Many days? 14 days a year anyway.
Yeah, but it could apply to the health center more. And you're right.
Yeah.
If you can manually keep track of it so that we know that
they're
going to
plop in 56 hours, make sure they get 56
Well, but if
hours.
They're part-time, we wouldn't want to do that.
Well, you're saying you have to give them 7 days.
No, they earn 1 hour for every 30 hours worked up to 56 hours.
Well, well, we're not going to have that many people.
So
that's our take on it.
Yeah, and that may be the case, but we'll still have to comply. So if we think that we can handle it manually.
So how are you going to figure out if or how many this, like at the health center, say?
We'll have to work with the health center management and the Department of Corrections management to see if they can identify those employees that they work on these contracts.
And so at the health center, we're talking those who work on what contract with the federal government?
The Veterans Administration.
Good.
Is what DD, and I talked to DD and she said they have people.
That would be in long-term care probably.
Yeah.
Veterans that
yes.
come over to long-term
yes.
care and the VA pays us.
The yeah. one that
so,
we have the contract
for. Yeah, so all the nursing staff and all of the nursing
dietary.
Assistants, the dietary,
yep.
the housekeeping,
OTPT,
the recreation therapy people, anybody that would interact with those residents.
So basically the other end of this or the other side to this is we don't contract with the federal government.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
So we have a great relationship with the VA, but now this come into play. So to get away from it,
yep.
you just don't contract with the VA.
Yeah. And that works for this executive order because it exempted Medicare and Medicaid, but some of the other executive orders do not exempt Medicare and Medicaid, and so some of these other executive orders that we have coming, we may still have to apply to the health center unless we stop taking Medicare and Medicaid payments.
Okay, wait a minute. Say that again?
There are other orders out there.
There's other executive orders.
That might
this one particularly exempts Medicare and Medicaid.
Oh, okay.
Other executive orders do not.
Do not. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So, but again, that could be, I mean, it's the same way at corrections. It could be a revenue generator, but in the end, it could be costing us more so we don't take ICE or the federal marshals anymore.
Yeah. I don't know if you know the answer to this, but then the people we then subcontract with, the temporary staffing agencies,
we
would
have
also
to pass
have to comply.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, because they probably don't give
and
any
And if we have any state pass-through contracts from the state for roads, for construction, for Davis-Bacon, that would fall under this too. If it's a grant, no, but if it's a contract, yes.
If they know
my
that.
Question about grants, because we have some federal grants that occasionally fund or partially fund
yeah.
positions, and that doesn't apply.
No, this order does not apply to grants or excluded.
Teresa?
Most of the executive orders do exclude grants, mm-hmm. but I read a grant application about a week ago, and it troubled me because the grant, in the language of it, it said that they would be treated as if they were a federal contractor. And mm-hmm. so that is very troubling to me, that if the, because you, the executive orders, most of them exclude the grants, but if you put into the, if it says in the grant document that they're to be treated as if they're a federal contractor, I wonder if we are by agreement saying, no, we agree
so
to comply with all these executive orders. And then, so that was probably the reason and I just happened to notice that.
Don't have to put all that
points in
right now.
Do you remember what the grant
was? It was a very
area?
Tiny one. It was one for just a couple thousand dollars. And
it had like, how in the world could you divide
it
that up?
It might have been safe neighborhoods,
so
but I kept it. I set it aside.
I think
that's
more corrections than
so that's probably one of the joint
veterans. The only people that would be there for ICE or whatever.
Yeah, but that, there was language in there that was concerning about.
Because if it was,
treated like
potentially.
Or act like a federal contractor, and I was like, I wonder if we just brought ourselves under this.
Right. So what are our next steps, and
we're
determining?
We're continuing to work with the county attorney's office, and I'll be reaching out and talking to Dr. Foxall and to Mr. Tourville, and Dee Dee will, because she seems to be very knowledgeable of how this, who are affected or who's not, and I always keep Diane in the loop. So,
and the engineers.
And then I'll report back. Yeah. Right now, we have to look and see, do we have any other federal contracts that this might affect?
Mm.
So.
Wow.
Yeah.
This may be one that I think deems a presentation at the county board.
Okay.
Ooh.
Do you want to wait
the only thing
until we get some more information?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we want to wait till we have all the information, but it will be definitely one.
And it might be wise to wait until the regulations
come out.
That's what I was just going to say, is we could end up providing information that might not be 100% accurate if the regs come out on September 30th on our site, for example. So maybe we do it after then.
Yeah, let's talk about it again after that. We could actually come back around as an HR committee.
Yes.
And maybe updates periodically, but at some point when it's like real close, we need to get them.
Oh yeah, and I agree. Every question needs to be answered before you come up to the podium.
We will do our best to anticipate all of the questions.
Anticipate, because I can tell you what the questions are going to be. So,
well, then good. I'll come to you.
Yeah,
and
because I know how I can't anticipate every single question, but I can anticipate a lot of the questions. It'd be good that you have an answer to that question off the top of your head.
I'll be happy to. Get your expertise on that.
Good, sir. Since I'm psychic.
Yes.
Cool.
Well,
there could be a different psychic.
That's true. That's very true. And it could all. Yeah.
All right. Anything else on that one?
All right. Next is the update on the HR strategic planning initiatives.
This is the PowerPoint that Karen said you wanted loaded.
Yeah, page 9 is the specific page.
Nope, that's not what I wanted. Oh, there we go. Let's see. I'm thinking I'm in PowerPoint and I'm not, so excuse me. There we go, page 9.
Scroll down.
Oh, now I've got.
Just at the bar on the right and scroll it down. Nine. Keep going. Oops, I'm sorry, page 10. My bad, page 10. Alright, there we go. So this is the human and financial resources, 12-month technical priorities. Some of them do not pertain to human resources, but other ones certainly do. So the first one would be, I would think, consider discontinuing retiree coverage in 2017. And that's just something the county board is going to have to consider. It's about $2.8 million, isn't it?
$2.5 million. There, as we get into the budget, we're going to talk about some things concerning that. So I think, you know, Kathy's worked with me a little bit on it. So I think that is something that we're working on. There might be some changes to the plan that would take effect on January 1st, 2017 for retirees, but we got to discuss those in the context of the budget.
And we're going to be doing that through the Finance Committee, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me look down here. Develop a cooperative and internal legislative agenda. Legislation is under HR, and that's just something we do every year. So we're going to have a long session next year, so we might have more opportunities to get things through. Study changing to a PTO system, that's obviously a big issue.
Yeah, and if I could just comment on that, one of the things that I think that the county would definitely want to take into consideration about going to a PTO system is the Nebraska Supreme Court case on Roseland. Because right now, we are required to pay out vacation when an employee leaves. If you go to a PTO plan, you have to pay all the PTO out. Whereas if you keep vacation and sick leave separate, you don't have to pay the sick leave out. And I think that that's something that the board really needs, or the commissioners really need to take into consideration, because it could end up increasing costs.
Well, and this is one of those that, because it's always thrown out there, but nothing's ever done with it, that we need to at least do something. So if it's that, and the board says, you know what, fine, let's continue down and at least look at it and study it, at least we have direction. But what happens, and this is where commissioners get frustrated, is somebody will say it, nothing happens, and then maybe a year, 2 years later, either that same commissioner or another commissioner says, and they say, well, I asked for that 5 years ago and nothing was done with it.
Okay.
So somehow or another, we need to check it off.
Do you want HR to be the department to do the study? Because I don't think I knew that.
Yes, it would be. Yeah.
All right.
I guess I'm delegating it to the HR committee.
And that, again, it could be as simple as saying what you just said and wanting direction if we still want to use our resources to continue down that path, knowing that information.
Okay.
All right.
You should, when the final regs come out on the paid sick leave order, the executive order, you should check that against the paid time off, because they put a provision in the initial executive order about that paid time off can qualify under the sick leave, paid sick leave executive order, as long as all the other requirements are met. You should just double check it against the final regs when they come out.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, develop a comprehensive county employee compensation plan.
Matt, our compensation coordinator, has started working on this, and what we're doing right now, as the beginning stage of this, is we are taking every job description that we have within the county, and we're grouping, we're grouping them together by the amount of work experience that is needed for the job and the amount of education that is needed, just to start with a very broad stroke. And then we're lining those up and grouping them. And then we're looking at the pay spread between those jobs as they're grouped together. So that's our first step. And then we'll move to a more finite view as we continue to go. At this point, we're not looking outside for data because we don't have funds to hire a consultant to do that. So this is really going to be just an internal review done by our department, but at least it will maybe give an idea to the board as to whether or not they want to take the next step to engage a consultant to do market research for us with comparable counties. But this will just give us an idea.
And also, you know, I'm sure you have a copy of the 2009 Fox Lawson study, which basically was an outside consultant coming up with a plan.
And we have resurrected that. We are looking at that. We'll probably be pulling some of the main concepts from that, because you're correct, Patrick. Very few of those things were implemented at that time. And I was here then and worked on that with Mark, and cost was the biggest factor for not implementing, if I remember correctly. But
yep.
So, oh, sorry, Dan.
Are you doing it for non-union civil service only?
We're doing it every position in the county.
Even union?
Even
okay,
union.
I thought so, I just wanted to
even the
sure.
County attorney's office,
okay.
And the public defender,
great.
Because the commissioners requested that, so.
And so, timeline-wise, if we did a Gantt chart.
We were hoping that it would be September. We would have it by the end of September. It may get pushed to October because of the executive orders and the 1095C with the patient protection. We have a bunch of work to do by June 30th to get our electronic transmission done on that. So, but our goal is to still have it done by the first part of the last quarter.
Okay.
So that we have time to discuss it before. I know that was a concern,
right,
about doing any kind of adjustments.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. That's still the plan.
Okay.
Enhance employee wellness policies and program. And I know that is an ongoing process. We've done a lot. That'll be continued. I mean, there's obviously a lot of other opportunities that we continue to look at to enhance the wellness plan.
In that, when Aon goes to look at, you know, whether we renew or not renew, or then the board decides to renew or not renew. In that new renewal, are there additional things that we are looking at them doing to enhance it, or have we not got that far yet?
Well, there are different available options that you can add to the wellness. One that I can think of right off hand is disease management, where they reach out, you know, to the individual that might have a particular disease or whatever. We have some of that on United Healthcare, and that's why we chose not to elect that option. We did this year add the coaching, And I think I looked, there's 34 people that are doing the coaching right now. And that can be anything from tobacco cessation, nutrition, exercise, any of those sorts of things that coaching would work with. But there are other things that can be added at additional cost, for sure.
Well, that may be, again, another kind of presentation that we have here, that if Aon talks to them and we decide, yes, we're going to renew that, so then let's look at what additional options there mm-hmm. are, and then decide if we want to go with them this year or wait or whatever.
Okay.
So whenever that time frame comes, to have that, again, a presentation at the HR committee.
Okay.
I believe the succession plan was discussed at one of the recent HR committees, or else it was at the budget session. I don't know. I've gotten mixed up. But I do know that there are some things that we can do to help formalize the succession plan. And it's not naming an individual, but it's putting a process in place to start to identify internal talent that could be, even if it's multiple individuals in a department, groomed to become a successor. And I think that there's some formalized process that we could put into place. I just, quite candidly, I'm not sure how we would be able to get that pulled together before the end of the year. If we can, we will.
Mm-hmm.
But it may not happen, you know. But it looks like it's a 12-month under the 2 to 3 year. But if we had to move it out another, you know, quarter or two, I think we could probably help with some deliverables on that.
Okay.
Okay.
I think that's it for
HR. Yep. That's enough, isn't it?
Okay.
A lot to deal with.
It is. We have a great, great team, including the county attorneys and the clerk's office and the commission's office. Everybody pulls together. It works really well. Okay. Can we do other business?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is an update on the Fair Labor Standards Act. This is another, we had kind of talked about this earlier, I think last year, around the time we were talking about pay changes and increases. The revisions were announced yesterday. They have identified that they are increasing the salaries test threshold, which up till now has been $455 per week, and they are nearly doubled it to $913. And so now, in order to be exempt, you have to earn more than $47,476 annually. So we're working on that. There's 10 departments with 21 jobs and 41 incumbents that will be impacted by this, and that are currently exempt that will have to be reclassified as non-exempt. And we'll be working on contacting those departments and getting the job descriptions changed, making the necessary changes in Oracle. Attached is a list of the job titles, and this is preliminary. We need to go back and double check, but we've been working on this in anticipation. The departments that have the largest number of incumbents is actually law clerks in the county attorney's office, the assistant branch managers in the treasurer's office, who are supervisors. They will now be non-exempt. And then we have individual single incumbents, but 41 altogether. And
so can I just clarify,
yes.
So I'm totally understanding
mm-hmm.
this. So this is, originally it was anybody who made $23,660 that qualified for, or was,
could have.
Could
mm-hmm.
have.
Mm-hmm.
So now they've revised it. So now we had to go back and look to see who made $47,476.
Correct.
Annually.
And what we did was we looked at the minimum of the pay range, because of the fact that if we don't make the that job's whole pay range, then at some point, as they progress through the steps, they would go from being, they could go from being non-exempt to exempt, but then we would have to manage that, and that would be administratively burdensome, and if we miss somebody, it would be a problem. Even people going from a full-time position to a part-time position will have to be monitored now. There will be a lot of, monitoring on our end going forward. But that's correct in general what you said, is that those individuals that previously were exempt now will have to change to non-exempt.
And they'll get the overtime.
Overtime, they can get compensatory time because we're a local government. We do get a break. That we can offer that. We just have to make sure that our personnel policies or the contract states that we're going to give compensatory time and a little overtime.
Okay.
Patrick? I think you misspoke. At law clerk in the district court. Now, if there are law clerks in the county attorney, obviously it would apply to them, but they're not going to work
just
probably over 40 hours in a week anyway.
I think they've always been hourly and non-exempted. For the law clerk, there are law clerks. I think they're for Doug Johnson,
yeah,
for the court
right.
administration.
Mm-hmm.
But they're under your department.
No, it's a bit confusing. These folks, I think, work for the judges and are paid
full-time
through Doug Johnson's office.
And I think
and
most of those,
yeah,
most of these mm-hmm. positions probably aren't going to be working more than 40 hours a week anyway. So it's really not going to be that much of an impact. To the county, to the budgets, I would
actually
think.
Most of these people that are on this list are full time.
Well, I know, but they're not going to be working. Practically speaking, they're not going to working 40 hours a week anyway. I don't think
some of them do. Like the assistant branch managers may, if there's extended hours or
right.
if they have issues. But you're right.
If they're full time, they're not working 40 hours.
Beyond 40 hours.
Because there's not going to be a need for. I don't think the staff auditor in our office is going to be working overtime.
I thought you said the other.
Right. So, and I agree, and, you know, that's, and even if they do, they could have compensatory time, which it just causes a few more hours of time off instead of pay, but at least it doesn't have a hard budget impact. It's more of a soft dollars cost. So, the other thing is that they're going to adjust this every 3 years.
This is.
And so the first adjustment is scheduled for January 2020, but they have to announce it 150 days in advance. So we'll know August 1st of 2019 what that amount is going to be. So we'll have time to prepare.
I guess
for
it
that.
Depends on what Trump's going to decide to do. Just kidding.
What?
I said I guess it just decide on what Trump. It depends on what Trump is going to do when he gets in office.
So.
And I said just kidding for the record. Just kidding.
Oh my goodness.
Or not.
Who knows?
Okay, and then
My only question was for Teresa. Thanks.
I'll try.
Like, do you know that this make this in that window for the 60-day congressional period? Or is this going
to
carry over?
I have to check because it came out real close. I think I don't know the answer to that without going to double check.
Okay.
Because when we went to that seminar last week, I thought that it had to come out Friday the 13th.
That's what I thought too.
Or
so.
Monday the 16th to make it inside the congressional window.
Yep.
And they issued it late last night.
Yeah.
And they may have missed it by day.
So what's
that? No, the New York Times didn't say that. So.
What does that mean?
Well, so Congress has 60 days to review it. If they don't have this on their desk,
mm-hmm.
within a 60-day period, it can carry over to the next congressional cycle. So the potential for a veto by the next presidential administration is much more likely. And then this...
And it also
goes
extends
to dust.
The review period. My understanding is... They would normally get the 60 days if it falls short because
right.
Congress stops.
They get another 60.
They get a brand new 60
yep.
days because it's a new Congress and there could be different people. Incumbents could have gotten voted out, so it's new folks in there. So they get a 60-day window. So it almost
top
doubles,
of the new president.
It almost doubles the time of the review. It has a possibility of delaying it. And it possibly, if they say, oh no, we need the full 60 days, trying to push it in front of a new president. So there's possibility for some change and some delay here, but we won't know that till we get there.
Okay.
And that's on the Fair Labor
yes.
standard, that one
yes.
where you said it was going to be reviewed every 3 years?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This whole thing, even the change in the dollar amount, that could apply to.
Okay.
But from the HR practitioners world and from the labor attorneys world, they're saying organizations need to be prepared to implement it January 1st. So we'll start down that road, and we can always pull the plug at the last minute if it didn't meet the 60-day congressional review period.
Okay. Any other questions on that other business?
January 1st.
December 1st. I have one other, I don't know why it didn't get on the agenda, but a while back we kind of conversed a little bit about any kind of policy that had to do with caregiving for employees or employees being the caregiver, whether it be their elderly, their disabled child, or whatever. And I'm correct, right, that we don't have anything?
The only thing that we really have is that employees are allowed to use up to 40 hours of their sick leave for non-FMLA-like care and up to 80 hours if it's an FMLA care situation, but most often that 80 hours or 40 is not sufficient.
Right. So maybe Marcos can help with this because he's really good at research. If we could just find, like, if there is policies out there that we can at least look at to see if maybe that's something we would want to take into consideration to draw up a policy on. My concern on that is, you know, we have, it really was the aging population issue, and that our employees are in that state of where they're going to be the ones kind of jumping into the caregiver role. And it's a different world, and it's a scary world, really, when you're trying to balance work and family, and especially if you're caring for, just say, your parents, and not knowing if you're going to be able to do that or not. And so I would just like to see if there's something out there that we can look at, and if not, you know, maybe draw something up, and if we deem it good to take forward for something, great. If not, that's fine too, but it's a concern. And we're entering into that world, especially with the age of our employees. Anything else?
I think there was. FMLA.
Oh.
yeah, sorry, this is the MLA. In December of last year, we went to Cigna to do our FMLA administration.
Oh.
And we had I don't know that it's called a premium holiday, but basically we didn't have to pay any premiums for the first 6 months. We're coming to the conclusion of that, and our department has spent a considerable amount of hours preparing to go to Cigna. We have to upload all of the FMLA information that we had on every single employee into spreadsheets. We had to cross-check, double-check. We had to download sick leave information and put it into the spreadsheet. Tim spent hours with Calpina working on a transmission file that we send to them every 2 weeks that's supposed to provide all kinds of information about our employees, their home address, their phone number, their social security number, date of birth. I mean, it's a huge transmission file. So we've put a lot of work into this, and we've conducted, Diane and Tim and I have conducted training sessions with department heads, elected officials, and we spent time training department contacts. And where I'm going with this is it's not working very well. We're finding that our large departments are, we thought it would save them a lot of work, and it did save them some work. But now they've created other processes to manage the issues that have arisen with Cigna. And now they're spending about as much time as they were before. It's just different. And our department, specifically Tim and I, probably more so than anybody, have spent a lot of time dealing with all the issues that are arising because of the problems that we're having with Cigna's administration. And then we're also, because we're getting complaints from employees, we're getting complaints from department contacts, we're getting complaints from department heads, and we've recently gotten our first complaint from one of the unions. And what's happening is their process is really geared for companies, organizations like ours, if they have the short-term disability insurance plus the FMLA administration, they get a lot of information from the short-term disability application and that type of stuff. And so beginning the 1st of June, we're supposed to start paying Cigna. And roughly it's about $35,000 a year for them to manage this for us. And I personally do not think that it's advantageous that the department director is meeting. I brought up Cigna, said we've been with them for about 6 months now. What's everybody's thoughts about it? How many of you are pleased? Raise your hand. And nobody raised their hand. One person did say it's working okay for my department, but that was out of everybody that was there that day. And I didn't want to ask the question how many people weren't dissatisfied because I was afraid it would turn into a complaint session. But I just think that we've had employees that their child has had brain surgery and they were denied FMLA by Cigna, and it took them 2 months to get it approved.
Why?
Because Cigna makes our employees jump through all kinds of hoops, and their form is more detailed than the Department of Labor's form. If it's not fully completed, they send it back to the employee to tell them that they have to go back to their doctor to get the blanks filled in. I've had one conversation with a healthcare practitioner in Omaha who says, this is ridiculous what you're making your employees go through. And I heard just the other day from the health center that they're getting more complaints from their employees because the employees' doctors are starting to charge them to fill out the FMLA papers. We had one employee that had incurred $90 of copays because she had to go back 3 times to her doctor to have the FMLA form filled out. She was very upset. We had one employee that had surgery and she has diabetes, and her FMLA was denied for 2 months because her doctor wouldn't put an end of duration date. And in talking to the employee, she ended up actually coming back to work and being here before they approved her FMLA because the doctor couldn't provide a duration date. These are things that we would not require our employees to do. So what I guess I'm requesting is that we look at terminating the contract for Cigna on the FMLA. For the $35,000, I've talked to Tim. I think we could bring a person into our department on a part-time basis and handle what Cigna's doing a lot more efficiently, a lot more accurately, and a lot more quickly than what my biggest concern is, and I've talked to Teresa a little bit about it, is that we're also hearing that employees are saying, Douglas County implemented this so that it would discourage us from taking FMLA.
Well, of course, that's what they'll say.
And we would not want to be faced with an interference claim because our employees feel like this is too difficult. Mm-hmm. So that right now is where I'm at. I know Tim and I have talked about it, and he's in agreement. I've talked to several other department contacts, and they're saying either make it go back to the way it was or figure something out different, but drop Cigna because this is not working.
Just that part of the contract.
Yeah, the long-term disability, right now we've only had one claim and they denied it, and we're in the appeal process on that.
Would this be open session, or I assume it'd be county board meeting?
Mm-hmm.
Should we just get on the agenda?
To terminate it.
How quickly do you want to go to next Tuesday, or?
Oh, I guess I would ask.
Well, I think Diane Were you gonna look at the clause?
Yeah, there's a 90-day notice termination clause. And I will add that we have had meetings over the phone and one personal meeting with Cigna at least every other week and lots of phone calls that these two have done.
And Diane too.
And you know, they've replaced an employee that was assigned to us, gave us someone new. Thank you, but I don't know that that's helped. We brought up a lot of concerns, and on some of them, they said we just can't do that. This is what we have in place, and we can't. So, I mean, there's been a lot of discussions with them to try to get this fixed, and even with that, and they have helped it somewhat, but not, I don't think enough.
They've added questions to the, you know, they've added additional information requests to their forms of information that we didn't request. In the past, and it's not on the DOL, Department of Labor forms. And in discussions with them, their lawyers tell our lawyers, so to speak, between the four of us, that, you know, in effect, that's what we're going to do, and, you know.
They won't bend on it.
And they won't bend on it, basically.
On things that an employer could discretionarily change.
Yeah, because it says
change.
May,
yeah.
And they're saying, no, we won't, because we're going to treat everybody exactly the same.
Yeah, it may be an overreach, but it almost seems kind of like there's a gotcha thing going on here with trying to, I don't know if it's purposeful, but it all these extra questions that they're asking the employees to do, any one of those could trigger a denial if they're not completed properly.
Yeah,
isn't
anybody
company.
Been denied?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And we've fought and fought and fought, but there have been a couple of situations where the employee just gave up and they denied it.
Yeah, I mean, we had one where it was I think it was a parent that had congestive heart failure, and it was kind of similar to that where Cigna wanted to know, you know, duration. Well, you know, you're not cured of congestive heart failure.
That's
you know,
right.
You know, ultimately, you'll probably die from it. You know, and so there's no. It's not like, you know, having a broken leg surgery where it's, you know, it's going to be 2 months and it's done, you know, whatever.
But our purpose of this was to get a better handle on the FMLA cases.
Consistency between departments.
Between departments, mostly. And I think that if our department takes over part of what Cigna's doing, we can ensure that consistency is there without causing all of the side effects that we've had that have occurred because of Cigna's processes that they don't really want to change.
Okay. Teresa?
No, I got it.
So when do you think county board meeting to discuss it? /discussion/action, just discussion, and then a follow-up resolution at a later board meeting. I think maybe we should discuss it first, and then if that goes well, then at the subsequent board meeting, have a resolution to terminate the contract and to authorize, you know, you to hire, you know, use that money to hire somebody. So would you want to present it next Tuesday, or would you want to? Because we don't meet again after next Tuesday for another week.
Yeah, I can do it next Tuesday.
Well, is it within the...
Yes.
You want to do this publicly? I mean, I don't...
I don't know.
I have to defer to you all.
It's contract negotiations in a way, but in a way
we're
it's also...
We're kind of doing it publicly now.
I think we have to do it publicly. Yeah.
I mean, that's the part.
So the discussion basically wouldn't... The discussion would be the 90-day, that
mm-hmm.
the discussion is terminating the contract within that 90-day.
Could we do that in executive session?
No, I would do everything in open session. We're
okay.
Doing it right now in open.
Yeah.
So just give them tell them next Tuesday and go down and talk to Sharon, get it on the agenda. Discussion regarding county FMLA administration by Cigna. Discussion regarding county FMLA administration by Cigna. And then just tell them what you told us today and have that conversation with the board and then say, well, this is what we think would work better. You're spending that money anyway. Spend it this way. And then... Tell them that we will have a resolution on the agenda at the next board meeting to give the 90-day termination notice to Cigna and to hire somebody with that money.
I don't think it's a... Go ahead.
The other thing we could do is it could be that Cigna is okay with this and doesn't need 90 days.
Yeah, I
and,
yeah.
And it was Aon that kind of
yeah.
helped with this. So, I mean, it might be okay to have
Tracy
talk to them and just say, look, I mean, we've had conversations with Cigna. They know about the 90-day. We ask them. Sometimes things just don't work out.
Right. We had a meeting in person with them, actually, with the account manager, which was very helpful. We thought maybe we were going to get some changes, but they didn't quite occur how we wanted to. But Tracy was there. They clearly know that we're not happy. We've had as Diane said, multiple conversations, and we've had, you know, with Diane on the phone saying, I'm looking at the regulations and this is what it says, and what you're doing is not what the regulations say. And they're like, well, this is the way we're going to do it. So it's been hard even to coordinate workers' comp with it. So.
Did you have time?
I was agreeing with Diane. If we mutually agree with them, we don't have to do the IEP. But if they refuse to agree, we have to follow the IEP.
Well, and again, I don't think this, it doesn't have to be a negative thing. It's we gave it the old college try. We were looking at a different way of doing something and it didn't work. And so now here's our plan B. And so I wouldn't look at it as a negative. I think it was very good that we gave it a try and we found out that it didn't work. That's okay.
And really, and you pointing this out, I think one of the main reasons it didn't work is we didn't have that short-term disability plan along with it, because when they do that, the employee has to give them information or they won't get paid. Our sick leave is a little different, you know.
Yeah.
People can call and say they can get paid.
Right.
Other companies don't have a sick leave program like we have. They have a short-term disability program.
Yeah. Well,
so
that's all right.
It just wasn't.
That's okay. That's all I would just say. We gave it the college try, and we're going to go a different direction, and that's it. That's fine.
Yep. Okay, so that means we go back to how things were before.
Well,
unless there's another employee that gets hired.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So with that, Mike, so I think that's what you talk about too. That so here's where we were. This is what we did about it. We're wanting to change again, and so now this is our plan. So with that money that we're spending on this contract, we feel it can be better spent by bringing the staffing house and doing it with a part-time person.
Okay.
It's not in the budget? Or,
well,
it would be in the budget.
Well, no, we were paying the Cigna that, you know, when we could pay that out of the health insurance fund. You know, to pay an insurance company, but we couldn't pay an internal employee out of the health insurance fund.
Can you, can that money be transferred to that department? Because it's being used for the same purpose, but in just a different way?
I mean, I'm sure we could
figure something out.
Figure something.
All right, we'll figure it out.
Yeah,
but
that
would
be important.
Yes.
For the board. No.
And that would be, well, and that would be something when that is brought up that we have figured out how it would be paid for. So, all right.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. Anything else? Okay.